After understanding the various aspects of brands, let us now focus our attention on driving social immersion and influencers. In this session, we will discuss what goes into the storytelling of a brand film that inspires customers to view, engage, and possibly drive a purchase decision. To know more about this session, may I now call on stage Mr. Rahul Sarangi, the Global Head Business and Content, Head at Viral Fever. It's called the first movers in the current digital ecosystem. Mr. Gopa Kumar, the Chief Operating Officer at Isobar. He has over 18 years of experience in advertising, marketing, and communication industry. Mr. Puneet Bekal, Director at Marketing Mastercard. A seasoned marketer with 14 years of experience across various verticals, FMCG, real estate, and retail. Mr. Amin Ghadaili, Director of Strategy, GoZoop. He's an entrepreneur in GoZoop for 3 years, leading the key accounts for the company and moved on to play the role of Director of Strategy. Mr. Hemant Jain, Senior Executive VP and Head of Digital Business, Lokmat Media Private Limited, with over 23 years of experience in building new businesses in the digital media, mobile entertainment, consumer broadband, and digital solutions space. This session will be moderated by Mr. Pinakin Tucker, Director of Nirvana Digital. Mr. Tucker has a great vision for his work. Thank you.
Hi. Has everyone had pakoras? Bhajias, sorry. Okay, cool. Okay, you guys know the topic of discussion. We don't have too much time. I think one of us is on a little bit of a flight to catch. So let's just dive straight into it. You guys want to do a round of intros? You want to start? Yeah? Okay, great. Okay. So what goes into storytelling and a brand film that inspires customers to view, engage, interact, and possibly drive a purchase decision? Let's start from there. Yeah?
I think the most important thing is how seamlessly you integrate the brand with the content. And the other important thing is which platform you're putting it on. Like if it's a Gillette Venus shaving brand, the women shaving thing, if you put it on a TVF or a TSP, it'll not work. If you have to put it on the right platform, and the content and the product has to be similar in nature for that sense. So that, and the other important thing is not only put the logo or just the product. How do you make that part in seamlessly part of the storytelling? I'll give you an example of that. So for example, if you see TVF's last hit is Kota Factory, an academy so seamlessly integrated, or for that matter, tripling one or two with Tata or with Drive Z. So it actually is part of the story rather than just another thing, because the consumer actually today is so smart and evolved, it gets a little pissed off and says, oh, I don't want to see it's they're trying to push this on me. If the brand seems to have a personality for you to engage on, then yes, people will engage on that piece of content, and so will drive the other brand objective that needs to be driven.
So I agree with what he says, but I would also want to just take a step back in terms of we keep on talking, and I just read somewhere, basically we keep on talking about in terms of saying what makes marketing work, what kind of content will work, what kind of social media platforms will work. I think not much emphasis is given in terms of to understand what makes consumer work very clearly. So first, understanding in terms of what consumer is looking at, that's one. And second thing is for brands who are looking for engaging and asking them to actually, let's say, click or view on that particular piece of content, you need to be authentic. In this day and age where you are able to actually see through a branded content very clearly, how to make that engaging. Unless, as he rightly said, if you can't actually have a persona which can be relatable for a consumer, nobody will be able to actually take that much of time and actually start viewing that content. So for me, one, and that's a very critical aspect of it, one brand needs to be authentic and has to have a persona so that it can actually start moving.
So I'll talk from a brand perspective. For a brand and the marketeers who handle the brand, it is important to land on a specific objective. So if you look at it, what is the action are you seeking from the consumer? It's very important to be clear before you start your brand story or the process of the brand, the creating content. Point in case, is the objective or the action you're seeking from the consumer is to increase frequency, or is it about busting myths, or is it about habit change? So until the time you're not clear about the landing point, I think you should be extremely clear about the landing point before you start the entire process of content generation. That's what I think.
Thinking about customers and, stories and other aspects that we are building, and persona specifically, I believe one thing which is imperative and at the base of everything is the connect. What is the kind of connect that you're trying to build with the brand and between the customer? Is it an emotional connect? Is it an aspirational connect? What is the kind of positioning of the brand that you're holding in this space? Like, I can share a couple of examples. One is while launching Mumbai Police's Twitter account at that point in time in 2014. At that point, the connect was very, very important for the citizens to make sure that they feel safe while interacting with the police online. At that point, police was viewed in a little bit of negative light, but at the same time, there was a lot of positive sentiments around it. So how do you make it more approachable on the street and even in the digital world was the connect that we were trying to build. Similarly, for Dell, India, we had the anti-rote campaign where we spoke to a lot of parents and we spoke about the objective of a student, obviously, studying is not to just rote learning is not the only way. I mean, there's a deeper understanding for the subject that is needed. So I think that connect, whether emotional or aspirational or anything of that sort, is very, very crucial from the customer and the brand's point of view. And then it should serve a logical purpose to the life of the customer, because people usually rationalize their decisions, though 95% of them are emotional, unless it's Apple. So that's a different story then.
So in my view, there are two points here. One is the whole art of storytelling, which is about creating branded content. And the other very important aspect is about distributing the content or publishing of content. I think so the dynamics have changed when it comes to digital as a platform or as a medium of distribution. So I would say in yesteryears, typically a brand film would be made by the advertising agencies. And during those days, you had a unified single agency taking care of all aspects of the brand management function, whether it was planning, creative, media release, etc. To today, where creation of branded content starts from an agency and ends up to an individual creator who's also called an influencer. So I don't think so there is a singular unit of brand film or content which would work today. So when you reach out to an influencer, depending upon the genre of influencer, his tonality of creating content, you would have to create a customized branded content, keeping the ethos of the brand in mind. And at the same time, the other very influencing aspect is the platform itself. So if you look at Facebook versus YouTube versus share chat versus TikTok, you couldn't expect the same content to work across all the platforms. So if you are a smart marketeer, you would, depending upon the kind of audience you want to reach out to and what format of content works, whether it is in terms of duration or in terms of the format itself, you would be much smarter in terms of taking the core idea of the storytelling or the concept and rendering it into multiple forms and factors to get the best output in terms of reach, engagement, etc., across multiple platforms.
So basically, to conclude, what goes into the storytelling is that you need to have a clear objective, what you want from the consumer. You need to be able to connect to the consumer. You need to understand the consumer from an agency standpoint, and from a brand creation standpoint, it can't be in your face. So the good thing is that, from a publisher standpoint also, since you brought up influencers, how does it generally work when a brand has to decide what kind of influencer to work with? And do you guys get pushback from the agency? Does the influencer get really smart and say, hey, listen, I think this will work for your brand? Do they put on that hat? How is it? Like, explain to us a little bit in terms of dynamics.
So we as TVF believe that influencers are the next big digital currency. But there's a small problem with that. It's a big fragmented market. There's no agency which manages them. So there's no, you don't know who's who and so on and so forth. And there are three kind of influencers. One is celebrity influencers. For me, a celebrity influencer is a Virat Kohli and a Amitabh Bachchan and so on and so forth. Then there's a digital influencer, which is what influencer actually is supposed to be. And there's a micro influencer. Micro influencer, for example, is have less than 40K followers on Insta and so on, but very big in Jaipur. It's like when we were kids, if you anybody from small town, you would understand, in your locality, there was an older brother who would say, chalo cricket khelne chalte, and everybody would go. So that is a micro influencer. So when you decide, so as TVF, what we have done is, we have gone to this new part of the business, which is called influencer content network. The most standard thing that the brands usually do is, hey, can you post a story? Can you do do another post or so on and so forth on Twitter, Insta, Facebook, so on and so forth. But actually, like you mentioned, most of these influencers are actually content creators. So
okay,
I'll give you an example. Amit Badana, 14 plus million, this thing, most biggest YouTuber as an independent person on in India. We manage him. The first thing is you have to have the back end sorted. Then what we are doing as TVF, and that is how the brands will leverage more, and so will the content creator, and so as we as publishers. So there are three parts to this, right? So first you need to have the influencer in your roster. So we have about 150 to 200, give or take, exclusively today, which we're growing at a very, very rapid rate. The second part is these people all have stories and very regional in that sense. A lot of brands today are saying, hey, can we go more native? I want to focus only on Tamil Nadu or TTMK or the entire Hindi belt, so to speak. So their stories, they don't have enough wherewithal. They have ideas. They don't have a script support. They don't have production support. At times they don't have enough cash support. And they don't even know how to reach out to somebody like in Mastercard for them to tell some story. So that's what we as publishers, large publishers like ourselves, come into play. So we output all these three things. We bet that, make that script better, aid them with what they need to make great piece of content, and get the brand involved and put it either on their platform, our platform, depending on how the strategy of that piece of content is supposed to work. And it will work for all parties. It'll work for him as a content creator becoming bigger. And I'll give you an example from a TVF books, right? So we created a show on Timeliners called College Romance. It was supposed to be three girls, an engineering show based on three girls' point of view, right? What we did is we didn't take actors. We took three different influencers who are girls who could act. They're not actors primarily first. If you can go online, 5 episodes, organic. I think 6 months has been. We've done 100 million organic views. Organic, we have not put a penny. And the second thing, these three influencers, their following Insta has grown sixfold. So it actually works for all parties. So what it does is the brand gets what they need, the content becomes better, and their storytelling ability goes bigger because you want to support these kind of people, empower these kind of people. And the third, what it does is their following bigger so that you can monetize them over a short term or a medium term. I'm not saying long term now, but I'm just saying short term to medium term. That's my limit.
So I have a point of view on this one specifically. You know, it's easy from a brand perspective, it's easy to match passion point of your audience, find a relevant influencer who the audience follows for the specific passion point, and figure and integrate content accordingly, right? But if you look at India as a standpoint, there are 22 languages, 1,683 dialects. Every 1,000 kilometers is a different culture altogether. I think this is a big opportunity, which from a content perspective, I think it's going to be a next big wave, where regional and languages is going to play, are going to be in the forefront of engaging with consumers. That is, I mean, probably you can add on to it.
Yeah. Yeah, from a platform standpoint and from an agency standpoint, what do you guys think?
While I agree on, again, 100% in terms of what sentiment has been echoed, my question again is, because this entire thing is nascent and it's just upcoming and it's booming and everybody is actually jumping into the bandwagon, the kind of content that is created, content creators need flexibility and freedom in terms of to create that kind of content. Are our brands ready or mature enough to actually give that piece of their baby, basically, and actually create that. Because more and more where we find restrictions very clearly is that this can't be done. This is a challenge very clearly. And internationally, you see that brands are in there. They are willing to actually put their money in the center of conversation for good or bad, very clearly, and are able to actually put that piece of content in the public eye to see what the response is. But in normal, generally Indian scenario, I think we would like to play safe. So are we ready for it? Is I would like to actually ask from a brand point of view and from a content creator.
So basically, the ISOBA as an agency would play buffer between an adventurous and a creative content creator versus a brand that could be adventurous or might
yes.
not be. Okay. Okay, great.
So, see, there are certain brand codes you can't move away from. Okay, let's be honest about it. And that's how brands are built over a period of time. And the brand's personality is built because you stick to it, correct? Having said that, again, I'm going back to the same point. If you're clear of what is the action you're seeking out of the consumer, how do you land at that point it's a creative call. You know what I'm saying? And it depends more than the brand. I think it's the individual is driving the brand. I'll say it loud. Yeah. That's how it is. Yeah.
So talking about regional, you know, we recently launched a studio business similar to what you guys do mainstream called Shuddesi Studios, and we launched a channel on YouTube called Shuddesi Marathi. We produced our first web series called Thrilling Pulling. That was our first venture, and none of us really come from a very strong production background. But we looked at the entire launch as a very interesting experimental model, and we said we would invest in content but not invest in marketing. And the best way to market like a typical startup would approach is to look at organic ways of building hype around the entire web series. It's a 6-episodic web series of 20 minutes each. So what we did right from the start, when we started to identify the cast, we looked at some of the stars who have currently been working in the Marathi television space, and they have a huge fan following on Instagram and Facebook. And we made a conscious decision to pick up those who were pretty active on the social media platforms. The second thing we did was we decided to completely move Lokmat out of our marketing mix, because we realized that Lokmat would be a very dangerous platform to launch a web series of this genre, which was rom-com, and I would run the risk of even losing my job. And my boss kept insisting that I should do a full page ad around the release of the web series, and I said, no, thank you. But what we did, we created a whole network of influencers, young influencers, I would say the Gen Z audience, and Marathi language. And we also reached out to very interesting Facebook pages, which were largely operating in the social viral content space rather than credible news space. And I must tell you, what we experienced was magic. We started with zero base on a YouTube channel, and it's not so easy today. And thankfully, you can't spend on Marathi because Google still doesn't understand Marathi. So that added up to the challenge. But thanks to the content and the entire virality we created because of the influencer mix which we created, and a lot of shoulder content and live on FB, because live on FB is what MSI really pushes up your content up. We were able to now garner close to 15 million views without a spend in 5 months' time. And I think so it's fabulous, because we are now about to touch 2 lakh subscribers on YouTube in such a short span of time, because within the category, people have taken at least 2 years to build a base of 2 lakh. So I really think so smart influencer marketing, if really, you know, analyzed well and planned well, works to the advantage of new releases.
Just to add to that, like a lot of people talk about digital and say digital is a medium. Now, when we further deep dive into it, we realize that digital is not a medium, digital is a space which offers multiple mediums. Now, when we also talk about influencers, like you mentioned, now every platform has its own set of influencers which influence. So the kind of TG that you get on TikTok may be very, very different compared to Instagram and the way you want to build it. In fact, it so happened we were chatting and we realized that one of the brands that we have helped build is micro-influencers and connecting them with deep passion points for our customers, which we usually call it as deep culture. because those content fireworks transcend caste, religion, barriers, and every other aspects that the society defines. These micro-influencers with a brand that we have been working called Ace Blend has helped us reach a base of 25,000 followers in a year, in 1.5 year span. And out of that, 75% actually are our customers. And we have not spent a single rupee. So even the influencers that we onboard, and we have a team that kind of scouts them, we actually reach out to them because the product is authentic. So there's something that they believe in and we have to offer. So that value is extremely, extremely crucial. Vis-a-vis compared to Star Bharat, which where we have created a very active community on ShareChat, and the kind of influencers that are present there, they're so in-tuned and so engaged with the characters that they would go to any extent to promote it. So it depends on what is the value, again, what is the passion point, and how we are connecting. And in terms of agencies, I believe that we are the gatekeepers in the sense to make sure that the creative component and the brand sensibility marries. And there is no disparity in that sense, because it can be really creative, but if it doesn't meet the objective, it's a...
So I just want to add one thing. You know, a lot of people still think agencies are either dead or they think that they're gatekeepers. I don't think they're either. For me, they are actually... they're empowering people in terms of content creators like myself, because logically, I'm just because I'm one of the content creators in this panel here, we are actually a very egoistic set of people. Content creators have massive egos, right?
Really?
Yeah. Ki ye mera idea kaise kharab ho sakta? You know what I mean? So, and you actually lose objective track of where the dollar is coming from. The agency is a right empowering, I would say, or to tell you, hey, buddy, relax, you kind of thing. And from the brand standpoint, because the brand is always thinking brand first. Because that's not the job to think creative. You know, they're the guys who are balanced. They're the balancing act, I would rather say. Yeah. And the agency is actually moving that way. And the faster they move, the better it is for everybody to make a dollar, cent, or whatever it is.
So, I mean, we were discussing earlier. For me to understand this, you guys used influencers who are not actors, but start them in the show, and that really worked for you guys, right? You guys used influencers in a similar sort of way as well. So influencers do have their part to play. It's how you use them, correct? It's not always about a conversation. Like, in fact, I think you were telling me about a conversation that occurred on some video of some traveler. You wanna just...
So for example, for the other end of the spectrum, which is the metro affluent consumers, one of the objectives is to encourage these consumers to use the Indian card when they're traveling abroad. Because a lot of perceptions and myths about using card while they're traveling abroad, like whether my debit card will work, is there a hidden charge when I'm using my card, etc., so on and so forth. So we wanted to use, again, using all the codes which we just spoke about, there was one specific influencer who showcased in a very subliminal way, not flashing the card in front of the post. Yeah. The card was not even seen, but somewhere it was construed or consumed in a manner where she used a card to get a metro ticket. And her journey of traveling in that destination, how experiential or priceless it was, using Mastercard was not there anyways in the content. But when you saw the conversation in the post below, it was an eye-opener, because many people ask, oh, can you use your card to buy a metro ticket? Yeah. And so on and so forth. So these are conversation starters, which is extremely helpful for the brand, because this is exactly what we wanted. So yeah.
Okay, great. So there's regionalization in terms of Marathi. You talked about TTMK. Regionalization from an agency standpoint, are a lot of brands asking you to maybe use micro-vlogging platforms like a TikTok or any other platforms to try? And are they asking you to buy inventory there? What are they trying to do in terms of regional smaller plays?
Yes, so the vernacular is growing big, and I think the time finally has come. I've been part of this industry for some years now. We keep on saying that vernacular will be big in India, but I think after post-GO, I think we've seen that very clear change and shift happening, where brands are now looking at vernacular very seriously. They have a vernacular strategy or region specific strategy, looking at platforms which are just looking at that particular geography. So TikTok, yes, is in demand. We are looking at how we can actually use, yes, brand safe, non-brand safe. These conversations are also happening, but the first hesitancy initially, where they said vernacular never used to work. Internet is a English medium, very clearly, or it's for people who are only reading English or writing English or thinking English basically was the mentality, but I think things have changed and more brands are actually looking at all of these platforms and having their vernacular strategy built in as and when they're moving in.
I think that works from a content perspective also. So for us, we run about 300 channels on YouTube. We do about 7 billion minutes of watch time every month. Pre-Jio, if a Bhojpuri video had 100,000 views, post-Jio, maybe 4 or 5 months after post-Jio, I'm now getting 800,000 views or 900,000 views. So the brand will obviously catch on, you know. So tell me this, from a data standpoint, do you guys, how does data work for you? Do you all do deep dives to understand how to create better videos? You know, I mean, people are using AI to create clothes today. So there must be some kind of data that you guys must be using to create content.
Well, so we have a data team for an app, which is, so there is a metrics, and everybody has their own IP on the technology that they use to do it, to be honest. So it'll be wrong for me to even say what our methodology is. But listen, I'm one of the, probably the few creators in the country who would say, you know, data can give you direction, but content has to be gut.
True.
You have to have a match of both. You can't, if you don't have data to back what you're trying to make and why, see, who you're making for, why are you making it? Who you're trying to reach out to? You know, if you don't, you say, you know, you want to make an Ethiopian thing, which has no idea, India doesn't understand Laila, to be honest, but it'll not work here. That's the truth, it'll not. Sacred Games will work here. Mirzapur will work, that's a DNA boss. We have to be real about it, right? So there has to be a data-driven thing, but gut has to be So I have three saying which I keep saying. Data gives you direction, content is the king, and distribution is the King Kong boss. And all three are together, you are home and dry.
What about marketing? Marketing should be the queen, right?
Yeah, but distribution is that. What is distribution?
True. Okay, any other inputs on data?
Even from the distribution perspective, like a lot of media campaigns that are being run, even when content is created and mapped, the numbers for regional content is much better. If you actually target it and do it, like example, when we were working with Arijit Singh Live, All India Tour, some of the campaigns that we did in Delhi were run in Hindi, compared to Bengal was run in Bangla. And the CTRs, the conversion overall, the kind of chatter was much better when regional content was promoted and distributed in that sense. So that is an ongoing trend, even from a native content creation perspective. When there's an event happening on any kind of activity that you're planning, when the content marketing is done in more regional languages, the ripple effect of it on the website and traffic and conversion end to end, if that is the journey that we are tracking, is much, much, much higher and better because the affinity is kind of solid. And I think.
So I think, Sid, my view, our entire appetite for data and measurement has gone up so much that we have really killed the art of storytelling. We are more bothered about views and reach and engagement even before, you know, from concept to screenplay to dialogues, the whole script is ready. And then, you know, you have so much of pressure from the client will, from his boss and to the agency, that then there is this whole science of saying after every 3 minutes, there has to be a slang. After every 6 minutes, there has to be a scene. I don't think so this is really going to work. In my view, if you've created a great piece of content, where the content stands alone and is able to engage you, with, that will automatically drive watch time. And if you like, you will share. And because you would share, there would be more organic views which would drive in. So today, if I look back and being in digital since 95, 96, I would look at an era from 95 to 2000 before the first dot-com bust happened. I believe some of the most wonderful work on internet happened, whether it was Planet Asia, Netcraft, a lot of agencies I set up for, which was Euro, DDB, etc. We did some fabulous work on internet because we did not have the pressure of measurements. We did some interesting product play. Even if you look at some of the products, which include Google and Facebook, you would have never seen them advertising because the product itself was so engaging and was solving a problem that you latched onto, and it was, there was a virality within the proposition itself. So my take here to all of you would be, stay true to what you're doing. If you're creating a piece of content, build it around the whole science of storytelling integrated with the philosophy of your brand and the objectives you want to meet. go out in terms of where you want to reach out to your audiences, and you will see the result yourself. Don't worry about measurements and, you know, the number play, which is, you know, bogging us down today.
Gopa, I think you might have to head. So let me quickly ask you, from a measurement standpoint, today clients will say that, okay, listen, we did a brand integration, or we used an influencer, or we did some kind of branded video. What do they pay attention to? Do they pay attention to views, likes, shares, subscribers, watch time? What is it that makes them happy? Because there's sometimes, I mean, we all know that there are marketers who just want numbers, even though the numbers might not mean anything. So what have you guys experienced when it comes to this?
So it's a variety of emotions, from good to bad, basically, in terms of, so for example, again, so the usual metrics again work from your click, views, engagement, shares, and other things. The idea, again, what we were discussing earlier, the metrics or data is there, but in all walled garden or walled situations where we're talking to platforms, the data is not available or not able to share for whatever reason. You are actually challenged, or you are actually dependent on the platform creator or the platform to actually tell us what's happening. I think if the industry has to grow and obviously has to move and more money has to come in, it has to a certain bit of data, while I understand from an agency perspective as well, that analyzing of data will obviously kill creativity. That's again one part of it. But certain sense of data need to be actually built in or be given in terms of information like watch time or who's watching what generally as well, which obviously is not available as of now for a brand or for an agency. It obviously is typically in terms of what.
Sorry, we're giggling because I don't think TVF is ever going to reveal watch time.
I'll give you a logic of it. You look at any OTT, right? Look at Amazon and so on. Dream11 to anybody. Actually, none of them believe they're content companies. They're tech companies. So that tech is your gold mine. So I'm telling you, this will never happen. It's not that we don't want to do, we still share a little part of it, but a Hotstar or Netflix, they will never share, give you anything. The only thing that you can, and that is, again, it'll skew you in a different way, like you said. I think the way to gauge or figure out whether it worked, not worked, you will see results, right? There are two, three things that the brand need to do as well. One is, don't do one and expect magic to happen. It's never going to happen, boss. I'm telling you as a matter of fact.
You need consistency.
Yeah, you need to have a 2 to 3 quarter plan at least to put on similar kind of content and then course correct. The other thing is, what are you doing this content for? The objective of the content, in my mind, is fairly simple. You're trying to start a conversation. Can that conversation, you're lighting a fire, can that fire begin to a bushfire? Yes or no is what your content will work. That is what it is, the reality of it is. So if you can create a piece of content which can go conversationally viral and virally viral, whichever way you want to call it, if that works, and over a period of time, then yes, it has worked, and then you can course correct. See, at the end of the day, I have this one line which I keep saying. The brand and the publisher, the publisher and us are not on two sides of the fence. We are on the same side of the fence. Yeah. Because we are trying to make, his brand needs to work, my content needs to work, overall it needs to work for the audience. So we are actually on the same side of the fence. The more collaboratively you work, the better it'll be for everybody involved. I mean, that's my limited point, eh?
Okay, cool. I think we've covered all points just in time. Should we open up the floor for questions?
Mike, yeah. So in terms of, each one of y'all, you said you got to plan a quarter in advance or 2 quarters in advance. What about, that's your strategic video marketing. What about short-term tactical moves that you have to make?
Sorry?
Short-term tactical moves, or any tactical initiatives, content initiatives.
So again, there's an entire plan that you actually make. So one is obviously a long-term strategy where you, as clearly you have planned out, you know your marketing calendar and you know where, what are interventions that you need to do, where are the peaks which are happening. That's one, which is an always-on hygiene kind of a thing that continues. For the the peak or the unexpected thing, why we call moments marketing clearly, or trying to actually hijack a particular moment or a scenario, let's say be a Virat Kohli or an election, you have to be
or
actually...
the Sunny Leon moment also. Yeah. The Sunny Leon moment
the
also.
Sunny
that was
Leon
a perfect hijack.
With, yeah. Republican Arnab and Manforce taking it, basically a very simple piece of content which was created, but actually got them so much of eyeballs, conversations, etc. So you need to be obviously listening to the entire spectrum and always on and looking at opportunities where your brands can intervene. And that's what we as an agency do recommend as well.
And just to add to what he's saying, as content creator, na, you have to be very nimble for such things. You have to be really quick-footed on these things. Like you see that the Sunny Leon classic example. Move quickly. Don't worry about kya hoega, nahi hoega, content land hoega, nahi hoega. Let's do this and see where it lands. And it most probably it'll
yeah, land. I'm going to add to this question. What about, we have, you know, in the advertising space where we have competitive moves happening. So what if a competitor is doing guerrilla marketing with your content? How do you deal with that? Do you go in for guerrilla marketing for video as well? You can't hear me.
It's too...
Okay.
Has to come up on the fly.
Depending on project to project, actually. See, the thing is, from the OTT standpoint, let's talk about that. And Netflix and Amazon Prime, they're not competing with each other at all. So to be honest, today we are actually moving a lot away from the YouTube, putting a lot of our thing. We are YouTube more as a marketing tool for ourselves. Because on... So basically what we're doing is... that guerrilla marketing only happens when you need to, but usually we avoid it because we are moving up from a YouTube business, which keeps as a marketing tool, as TVF I'm talking about, and we are doing output deals with all the leading Hotstar, Sony Live. Yeah. Yeah.
See, again, it all depends from brand to brand very clearly. Some brands would like to actually just keep quiet and do not want to actually get into that kind of banter. Certain brands which are pretty much open and, for example, all of these digital companies who are in there would want to actually get into that banter or would want to do a carry out a guerrilla marketing strategy clearly. So it depends on that kind of objective and the kind of moment that's happening at that point in time. And you decide then and there whether you want to actually get into that kind of a approach or a space, because if you are getting into that, you are ready, you should be open for good or bad, very clearly. And if that brand is willing to actually put yourself in that piece of conversation, yes, that's where it is.
Anyone else? Yeah.
So I think so it depends on your position of strength. So typically we have seen when the IRS numbers comes out, how confident you are about your numbers. So there are different ways those numbers could be interpreted. So there are definitely opportunities of guerrilla marketing, and in my view, it would be very sane on one part. If you're on the right track, you could really get on, you know, with some very, very aggressive modes. And what digital does to you today, it gives you a complete 360-degree, you know, channel in terms of getting super aggressive in reaching out to all the targeted audience, even within a geographical fence. And that geographical fence could also be a single pin code location in terms of doing guerrilla marketing.
So from a YouTube standpoint, the good thing with YouTube is you can implement quickly. Today, if you see a video that you want to do something against or complement, but see to it that your brand value rises at the same time, keeping in mind the position of strength, keeping in mind how quickly you will be able to engulf their viewers, you should be able to release it immediately. So the main thing is timing over here. I mean, guerrilla marketing, I really wouldn't call it guerrilla marketing. Maybe I'm getting the brand wrong, but there's this ad that I recently saw when the Mercedes CEO retired after, and then I think
BMW,
he goes home and...
BMW ad.
Maybe I'm getting the brand wrong. It's not really guerrilla marketing. It's more about intelligently being able to interact at that moment. That's the key when it comes to video or any kind of digital format.
And just to add to that also, in terms of guerrilla, like, it still has to be planned. It can't be really unplanned and out of the blue, because there are certain things which are timed. So in this sense, example, when Samsung bought over the keyword when Apple was launched, was a very guerrilla move. In fact, their entire upgrade program, when they released the ad when iPhone 10 came out, was something which was a guerrilla move, but it can't happen on the spur of the moment. It has to be planned. Unless it's a digital conversation that has been unforeseen, and then you decide whether you want to jump into it or do you want to stay away from it. And if you jump in, then just go all out and do it then.
Someone behind also had a question, I think. Yeah.
I have a question related to influencer marketing, just coming back a little bit again. So what I'm trying to ask is, when you guys choose influencers or when you guys create an entire influencer mix, what is the exact things that you guys look at in terms of who might be the right influencers for your brand and how genuine they are, and how do you attach a value to these influencers?
Yeah, it actually, honestly speaking, it all depends on, like he said, the brand objective. We usually categorize influencers as cat A, cat B, cat C, and these are certain parameters which are taken into consideration. But one of the most important things, that it depends on the authenticity of the brand and what are you trying to build. So if an influencer doesn't marry but your brand, but you want the influencer for reach or awareness or just eyeballs, then your objective is very clear. Then you're just aligning influencers from a more reach and awareness standpoint. And as long as that is met, that is good. If you're aligning influencers from an affiliate perspective, then sales and conversions are very, very important, because those influencers are directly influencers in the industry in which you deal. So it's very important to understand that influencer is very loosely, I mean, it's used very loosely as a term. There have been influencer bloopers also that have happened recently. Like, there was this one influencer with 2 million, she couldn't sell like 36 t-shirts. But, and that happened, that was the news everywhere, and everybody said that influencer burst myth, I mean, this is a bubble that's gonna burst. But when you look at Rock selling an Under Armour, those get sold out. Why? Because actually there is a direct correlation between what the brand does, what the personality does, and he uses it and he advocates it. So the authenticity of it is very, very important. We all live in an era where we all are very smart, and exposure now is quite widespread. It's no longer like before, that you saw an ad on TV that yeah, aapke baal sahi karega, and you'll be like, yeah, yahi karega. Now if it doesn't do, you are gone. You're doomed. There are 10 people who will say, mere baal bhi jhad rahe. So that is the era in which we are living. So I think that is extremely crucial. And I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
Cool. Any other questions? Wow, that means I think we did a good job. Thank you.